In this one, we're writing alpha, beta, and alpha, beta as products of disjoint cycles and as products of two cycles. The second task is going to be a little trickier. We've already done the first task. But now these are in S8. These are elements of S8, by the way. Previous example were elements of S6, or at least could be thought of that way. They actually can be thought of as elements of Sn, where n is bigger than 8. These could be thought of as elements of S9 or S10 or S11, et cetera, as long as you assume that the bigger numbers, 9, 10, 11, say, are mapped to themselves. You could consider them that way. That's more common if you're going to write it in cycle notation, though. Anyway, here, take it one at a time. One gets mapped to 2. You can see here which gets mapped to 3, which gets mapped to 4, which gets mapped to 5, which gets mapped back to 1. There's a 5 cycle, and then 6, 7, and 8 are permuted around. So that's writing alpha as a product of disjoint cycles. Those do commute because they're disjoint. I could have written them in the other order. Also, because they're disjoint, the order of alpha would be the least common multiple of the lengths of these cycles. LCM of 5 and 3 would be 15. Oh, wow. Order of alpha is 15. You wouldn't want to take the time to compute powers of alpha, would you? But we know from the theorem, the order of alpha is going to be 15. With beta, 2 gets mapped to 3, which gets mapped to 8, which gets mapped to 4, then 7, then back to 2. And 5 and 6 get permuted back and forth. That's a product of a five cycle and a 2 cycle. These are your disjoint cycles here. And therefore, its order would be the LCM of 5 and 2, 10. Not talking GCD, we're talking LCM, least common multiple. Not asked for, but the order of alpha would be LCM of 5 and 3, 15. And the order of beta would be the LCM of 5 and 2, which is 10. What's their product? Alpha, beta. I probably better be careful and write it all down here instead of trying to go back and forth. Alpha again is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 is a cycle, and then 6, 7, and 8. And beta is 2, 3, 8, 4, 7, and then 5 and 6. How can I simplify this? All right, as quick as I can. 1 gets mapped to itself, which gets mapped to itself, which gets mapped to itself, which gets mapped to 2. Going from right to left. 2 gets mapped to itself, which gets mapped to 3, which gets mapped to 3, which gets mapped to 4. Try to catch me if I make a mistake. 4 gets mapped to itself, then to 7, then to 8, then to 8 still. 8 gets mapped to itself, then to 4, to 4, to 5. 5 goes to 6, to 6, to 7, to 7. Hopefully no mistakes. 7 to itself, then to 2. It's got to go back to the beginning there. To 2, to 3. 3 gets mapped to itself, then to 8, then to 6. And finally, I think we're out of numbers. I better go back to 1. 6 gets mapped to 5, to 5, to 5, back to 1. Amazing. I went kind of fast, right? Probably faster than you're able to at the moment unless you get some practice. But it looks like, if I did not make a mistake, we have an 8 cycle there. The order of alpha composed beta is 8. Notice there seems to be no relationship between these things. And that is true. The order of a product may have nothing to do with the order of the individual factors. In general, at least. There are some special cases where it does. But now what about as products of 2 cycles that are not necessarily disjoint? Writing it as a product of 2 cycles is trickier. And when I say a product of 2 cycles, there's nothing about it being disjoint. These are not necessarily disjoint cycles. It's probably easier if you've got just one long cycle like this. And it involves a trick. So you got one long cycle there. Start with the first number. And write the last number next and make that one of your two cycles. Then do the first number again and write the second to the last number. Then do the first number again and write the third to the last number, etc. Until you get to the first number and the second number. This does work. It's a trick that works. Double check it. Does one get mapped to two? Yes. It gets mapped to two there, and then two stays fixed for the rest of them. Does two get mapped to four? Well, here two gets mapped to one, then to four, then four stays fixed. Does four get mapped to eight like it does up here? Four stays fixed, then goes to one, then goes to eight, then eight stays fixed. It works. Does eight get mapped to five? Eight stays fixed, gets mapped to one, then five stays fixed. Okay, so it's a trick. They're not disjoint. They all have ones. They do not commute. This is one way of writing this as a product of disjoint two cycles. That's the product alpha beta. How about alpha and beta individually? I could do the trick for each of these things individually. 1, 5, 1, 4, 1, 3, 1, 2, and then 6, 8, 6, 7. And then for beta, I could write 2, 7, 2, 4, 2, 8, 2, 3, and then 5, 6 is already a two cycle. So that's how the trick for how to write these things as products of two cycles. Why is that a big deal? If you've fully done the reading in chapter 5, it does come up. Products of two cycles. Question? Yeah, this is not unique. The answers are not unique. The answer is the way you write these things is not unique, but something that is the same, no matter how you do it, is whether the number of two cycles is even or odd. In the case of alpha, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 two cycles. In the case of beta, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 two cycles. No matter how I write alpha as a product of two cycles, it'll be an even number of two cycles. And no matter how I write beta as a number of two cycles, a product of a number of two cycles, it'll be an odd number. And when you multiply them, you're putting these all together, you could at least, you'd get an even plus odd is odd. There should be an odd number of two cycles down here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. It's not unique, but whether it's even or odd, number of them will be constant. Those permutations which can be written as an even number of two cycles are called even permutations. And those permutations that can be written as an odd number of two cycles are called odd permutations. And Sn effectively is, if you imagine as, say, a blob here, well, maybe a blob is the wrong picture. If Sn is a box, you imagine the symmetric group as being a box, and you distribute the permutations in Sn evenly, so to speak, in this box. Half of them will be on one side and half will be on the other. The evens over here, even permutations, and the odd permutations over here, and there will be the same number of them. Sn happens to have order n factorial. Therefore, the number of even permutations is n factorial over 2, and the number of odd permutations is n factorial over 2. Since the sum of any two even numbers is even, when you compose two even permutations, you'll get an even permutation. Moreover, an even permutation will have an inverse that's an even permutation. The subset of all even permutations is a subgroup of Sn, called An. Sn is called the symmetric group. An is called the alternating group, for reasons I'm not going to get into. Sn symmetric group on n objects, An the alternating group on n objects. An and Sn are very important historically in group theory. And especially once you get to n equals 5, things start to get pretty interesting in terms of understanding more challenging kinds of group theory. A5, which has got 60 elements, is a pretty interesting group in group theory. We don't really have time to study it in depth, but it's a pretty interesting group.